I hate everything being curated for me. It's like Spotify's Discover Weekly, Netflix, 98% match. Everything is being spoon-fed to me because of the algorithm and my choices that I've made in the past. But what? Where is the challenge? Where is the growth? Where is the discovery? That's what I want. I mean, Netflix says it's a 98% match, and they couldn't be more right, but I couldn't be more upset. I mean, let me make some questionable decisions for once. I want to buy an album that I might hate. I want to watch a movie that I'll never watch again because it sucks. So, 2007, I am 17 years old, and before work, every month, I would go to CD Warehouse, and I would enter that bargain bin, baby, and I would go there. I'd turn my back to all the gleaming jewel cases. I'd reach back, grab an album. If it was under $7, I'd buy it. Like, we're not talking about Whole Foods price sale here. It's not like now it's $14.99, but it was $15 for a loaf of bread. We're talking, you could get an entire album for 99 cents. I would listen to that album every single day for the next month because, well, it's 2007. All I had in my car was a CD player. No Spotify, no Apple Music, no fancy dancy, whatever title that we have now. All I had was a CD and I was broke. You know, those albums became the anthem for that time of my life. And it wasn't necessarily categorized by a specific genre because, again, I was just picking random albums out of the bargain bin. So, I got a unique taste of diversity. There we go. That's kind of what I wanted. Kind of. So I would buy albums that I didn't know if I was going to like. Most of the time I hated them. And then forced myself to listen to them because, well, it's the only albums I had. Years later, I would take this ethnomusicology class. You see, I had a brief stint where I thought I wanted to be a college student. Now, what I realized was, one, I grew up homeschooled, so the idea of having to sit through a lecture of someone telling me something about whatever it might be, instead of just going straight to the source material and reading it for myself, made no sense. And so I figured out I'm an outside learner, not a classroom learner. In this ethnomusicology thing, one thing stood out to me, and it was that if you listen to something that you hate, then you should probably listen to it more and figure out exactly what you don't like. Because the more you do that, the better you define your ear and define your taste and what you do like. And what lo and behold happens is you start to actually like the thing that you hated. But I wouldn't take that class for another 5 years. So what's 17-year-old Lil Squatch doing?
Well, it's certainly not because he had a great taste in style or anything. A common phrase that I heard myself saying during that time was, I don't like these shorts because they don't go past my knees when I sit down.
Now, I truly believe, without a doubt, those albums that I got as a 17-year-old were given to me from the hand of God. Not even joking. I think the main thing that I learned from being broke during that time was, you know, there's a lot of awful stuff about being broke, but sometimes there's little gems scattered amongst all the shit.
Well, and, you know, I will say, if I'm honest, one of the biggest little things.
There's an oxymoron, isn't it?
Is that I don't have to like everything, but I can't hate on anything. Sweet nectar of life. So let's dive just a little bit deeper into the psychology of that 17-year-old little squatch. I had just started dating my wife a couple years earlier. Now I know that she was gonna be my wife, and we've been married for 14 years. I had great friends, but when I was 16, I found out my father was wrongfully convicted and has been a sex offender for my entire life.
My dad was wrongfully convicted. My dad was wrongfully convicted. Dad was wrongfully convicted? All the times we moved, all the animosity, all the churches we were kicked out of, all the cleaning sidewalks and parking lots, pressure washing them, cleaning banks at 3 in the morning, it all kind of starts to make sense. Oh. That's why. I don't know if I ever stopped thinking about it. Not that I wanted to keep on thinking about it, but in reality, I think I thought about it for one day and then stopped. I never really processed it. I guess that's what I'm trying to say. Until like 2 years ago. Like, this film isn't for my dad. It's not a tribute to what a great man he is. And he is. It's for anybody that's felt emotions like I felt on that day. Those kind of emotions where you're it hurts to breathe. It's for those that have felt like the world is collapsing in around them. And they don't know if they're ever going to be able to breathe again or learn how to. It's for those people. The kids of the wrongfully convicted. The people that no one thinks about. That's who this film is for. So, that's all swirling around in the jelly upstairs for a little squash. That's why he did it. That's why I did it. I found escape. I found survival. I didn't know what to do. I didn't know how to make sense of the world. So I just shut out everything and found purpose in the chaos in that bargain bin. During that time, there was nothing that would stop me from exploring more music. I mean, ravenous is the only way to describe how. I mean, I would fall asleep listening to music and wake up listening to music. It was just constant. It lifted me. It lifted me whenever I was pretty much brain dead. I was just kind of a walking zombie at that point because my world had gotten flipped upside down. And so it kept me alive. And that's a pretty big miracle to me. And so I'm really grateful to music. So I hope that answers your question. If music is important for the documentary that I'm making, yes, it's very important to me. So until next time, be well. Do good work. Stay disciplined. The Blair Witch was filmed. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God.